Hello guys, today we'll have a discussion on the topic analysis of balance sheet. So there are three questions we are trying to answer in this video. The first question will answer the question, what does the balance sheet communicate? The second one will help us in answering the question, what are the balance sheet items that need to be considered for the analysis? And the last one is about answering how should we make inferences based on the analysis of balance sheet. So the first one, what does the balance sheet communicate? The balance sheet communicates the financial position of a company or an entity, right? So entity is a broader word. It consists of a sole trader firm, partnership firm, and a company. So we want to know what are the assets of the entity. We want to know the breakup of the assets of the entity, that is current assets, non-current assets or long-term assets, how much are the current assets, what are the quality of current assets, how much are the non-current assets or long-term assets, what is the quality of these long-term assets of the firm. We also want to know the liabilities of the firm, which can be decomposed into current liabilities and long-term liability, how much is the liability the firm is having in terms of short-term as well as long-term. What are the problems in settling the liabilities? Are there any issues with regard to the liabilities? And the last one is about the decomposition of owner's equity, which consists of basically capital and retained earnings. So that means we want to make use of all these items that are reported in the balance sheet of an entity in order to make some inferences about the financial health of the organization. In order to do that, what we are going to do is we are going to do a analysis, namely balance sheet analysis. The second question is this: what are the balance sheet items that need to be considered in the analysis of financial position of a firm? So I have listed down, right, these items. These are all basically line items which you can see in a typical balance sheet of a typical firm. Okay, so we are going to make use of all these line items in order to make inferences about a company. Who are you in this analysis? You can be a lender, that means you can be a banker, right, who has money and you have the proposal, loan proposal given by the company. So you want to know whether you can lend money to this company or not. You can be a creditor, that means you are a supplier of material to a firm. You want to know whether you can sell your product on credit to this company or not. Okay. Or you can be an investor, you have money with you, right? You want to construct a portfolio for your investment. So you want to know which are the companies in which you can safely invest your money and which are the companies that are going to give you higher returns, right? Yeah. Or you can be a manager, right? Or you can be a kind of equity market analyst, okay, equity research analyst. So you want to write reports about the financial health of a company, right? Or you can be working for an investigating agency who wants to know whether the company has made any fraudulent practices or not. Okay, so that means you are all interested in analyzing the balance sheet of your firm. So the question here is, given the balance sheet of your firm, could you make some sense about that? That is the question we are trying to answer in this video, right? Yeah, so for that, what we need is we need to have a balance sheet in our hands, preferably for the last 2 years or last two quarters, last two periods. Okay, and look for all these items, right? The very first item you need to look in the balance sheet is retained earnings of the firm. Okay, followed by that you need to look at the non-current assets of the firm, followed by that you need to look at the current assets and current liabilities of the firm, followed by that you need to look at the cash and cash equivalents of the firm, followed by that you need to look at the short-term investments, followed by that inventories, and then accounts receivable, and then accounts payable and accrued expenses, and then long-term investments. Finally, we will be looking at the capitalization of the firm. Okay, so the very first one is retained earnings. Okay, this is the single most important line item in the balance sheet of a firm. So when you are getting the balance sheet of your firm, you should definitely look for this number, right? So because it is going to give you the accumulated profits of the entity. Look at the words retained. The next word is earnings. Earnings means profit, otherwise known as income. So retained earnings means the profit which is retained by the firm after paying dividend to the shareholders. In case of sole tradership and partnership, you are talking about drawings, right? So that means after paying dividend, after adjusting for drawings, what is the cumulative profit made by the firm till this date? That is where we talk about retained earnings, right? So that means higher the number, better is the performance of the firm, and it should increase on a regular basis. On a periodic basis, you should keep on seeing a kind of increase in the retained earnings of the firm, okay? Please note these two equations which I have written, right? Retained earnings is not equal to capital, and then retained earnings is not equal to owner's equity, right? So that means what is owner's equity? Owner's equity is a sum of capital contributed by the owners plus retained earnings. So that is what you are, right? Owner's equity. So our focus here is on retained earnings. So we want to know whether the company has increased its retained earnings compared to its previous period. So that means we are talking about growth rate in retained earnings, which can be computed by this formula. Retained earnings at time T0 minus retained earnings at time T minus 1 divided by retained earnings at time T minus 1 multiplied by 100. Higher the growth rate, better is the performance of the company, right? Yeah. So I take you further. The second number you need to look in the balance sheet is non-current assets. So they are basically long-term assets. So what you want to know is, you want to know increase in non-current assets, because that indicates the future profitability of the firm. That means when you are having money, you want to invest in a particular firm, you can just look for this, right? Whether the company is increasing its non-current assets, okay? Particularly look for tangible non-current assets, which is otherwise known as PPE, property, plant and equipment, right? So what is that? That is nothing but your land, nothing but your building and your machine, okay? So look for that number, right? So look for whether there is growth in this PPE number, okay? So that means time 0 PPE minus time T minus 1 PPE divided by time T minus 1 PPE multiplied by 100 is going to give you what is your growth rate in PPE. Higher the growth rate, better is the performance of the firm, right? Can include capital work in progress in the computation. If you look at the balance sheet, sometimes you will find this item, namely capital, right, in progress. That means the fixed asset is in the making, okay? You may have a question whether you should include this or not. If you are going to include this for one company, you should also include this for other companies, right? If you are going to talk about cross-sectional comparison, right? Guys, here I am talking about, right, time series comparison. If you want to go for cross-sectional, make sure whatever treatment you are doing for company A, the same treatment you are doing for the other comparable firms, right? Yeah. Also compute the proportion of non-current assets to total assets and its change, right? So there are industries where non-current assets are significant, right? So find out what is the proportion of that. Also find out what is the growth in that, or what is the change in that, right? Yeah. I move ahead. The third number you guys are going to look in the balance sheet is combination of current assets and current liabilities, which is otherwise known as net working capital. That is current assets total minus current liability total. For example, if the current assets of the company is 500 crores, if the current liability is 400 crores, that means working capital is 100 crores, which is otherwise known as, right, net working capital. So what is this? This is the capital required for meeting your day-to-day operations. Okay. So also find out the proportion of net working capital to total assets. Find out the change in current year compared to the previous year. Okay. So now what does it infer? Okay. What is it you can infer from this? If working capital increases compared to the previous year, lenders and creditors are going to be happy. If it is going to decrease compared to the previous year, lenders and creditors will not be happy because their safety margin is coming down. So increase in working capital means you are attractive to the lenders, right, as well as creditors. Decrease in working capital means you are not attractive to the lenders and creditors. So that means you need to look from the perspective of lenders and creditors. I move ahead. I take you to the next number. The next number is cash and cash equivalent. Okay. So we know what is cash, that is cash and bank balance. What is cash equivalent? Investments in securities with maturity period not exceeding 90 days is considered to be cash equivalent. Increase in cash means all these things, right? It may indicate that it is going to, right, give more dividend to the equity shareholders. That means when a firm is increasing its cash, it may give the signal to the equity shareholders that they are going to receive more dividend this year. Or it may also give a signal of safety for lenders and creditors, improved safety for lenders and creditors. Or it may give the signal that the future investment prospects for the company is going to be good. Or it may give the signal that the future financial flexibility of the company is increasing. Okay, so these are all the positive signs of increase in cash. So that means more cash means, right, better the firm, right? But is it always true? If you ask the question, no, it's not always true, right? Why? Because there are managers who keep on wasting the money by way of going for mergers and acquisitions, which are not value creating, right? So that means the reputation of the managers need to be considered while answering the question of whether increase in cash is good or bad for the company, right? Yeah, I move ahead. The next number you guys are going to look at, right, is going to be, yeah, again, we are talking about increase in cash. Yeah, I already told you, analyze the, right, causes of increase in cash. Okay, so the good ones, that means these are all the things which are good one if you are going to talk about increase in cash, right, when it is coming from all these activities, right? That means the cash increases for the firm because you have collected from accounts receivable. The cash increases for the firm because it has come from increased cash sales, or it has come from profit from investments, or it is coming from, right, efficiency, right, activities, meaning cost reduction initiatives, right? So that means if you are able to generate more cash because of all these activities, it is good for the company. What are the bad ones? A company can increase its cash by way of selling the assets, which is not good one, right? The next one is the company can increase the cash by way of increasing its borrowings, which is also not good for the company, right? That means, right, you have to be careful when you are going to come to the conclusion about whether increase in cash is good or bad for the firm. The next one is investments. I have taken both short and long term investments. Okay, so investments means excess cash. Short term investment means what? Above 90 days and up to 1 year maturity period of, right, above 90 days up to 1 year is short term investments. Long term investments are investments, right, having maturity period above 1 year. Okay, so it provides the support for the lenders and creditors. So investments means good for the company. It signals positive, right, vibe to the lenders and creditors as well as for investors. So that means you have to find out what is the growth rate in investments. So T0 investments minus investment T minus 1 divided by investment T minus 1 multiplied by 100 is going to give you what is the growth rate in investment. Higher the growth rate, better is the, right, attractiveness of the firm. The next one is inventories. We discuss about current assets and current liabilities. Now we are looking at the individual components of working capital. Basically, three primary components are there, namely inventories and receivables, and then accounts payable and accrued expenses, right? So inventory is a broader term in accounting which consists of raw material, work in progress, finished goods and spare parts. So increase in inventory means, okay, it denotes or it gives a meaning of improved inefficiency. That means inefficiency has improved or increased. Okay, so it's a cause of concern for the firm. Okay, so however, if you are going to increase inventory, that also gives you benefits in terms of increase in sales as well as decrease in stock out problems. Okay, so that means you have to weigh the cost and benefit. Normally increase in inventory indicates, okay, decrease the efficiency of the managers, right? So you want to know what is the growth rate in inventory. That means T0 minus T minus 1 divided by T minus 1 inventory into 100. So that means inventory is expected to be lower, right? So that means it is coming under the rule of lower the better. It's not higher the better, right? Yeah, right. I take you to the next important current assets, namely accounts receivable, which is otherwise known as debtors. Okay, so this comes to you from credit sales. Again, it is coming under the rule of lower the better. So if your accounts receivable is increasing, it indicates that the inefficiency in collection has, right, increased. Okay, so it may lead to increase in bad debts. So it's a cause of concern, right? It may also give you the benefit. Increase in receivable means increase in sales revenue as well as increase in profits. Okay. Nevertheless, it is coming under the rule of lower the better. So that means if the accounts receivable increases drastically, that too in a period where economy is not doing well, that really creates a cause of concern, right? So what is the growth rate in accounts receivable or debtors? Time T0 growth at time T0 AR minus T minus 1 AR divided by T minus 1 AR multiplied by 100. Okay, so that's where we talk about growth rate in AR. The next one in working capital is accounts payable or creditors and accrued expenses. Okay, accrued expenses are outstanding wages, salaries, utilities, taxes, outstanding interest expense, all those things, right? Okay, so when these two increases, that provide immediate source of funding for the firm because you have delayed the payment of these two items, right? So higher the number, better is the performance of the entity. How much higher is an ethical issue. So if accounts payable comes down, it talks about poor bargaining power with the suppliers. It's a cause of concern. If accrued expenses comes down, that means you are paying promptly. Okay, that is good for the company. Okay, so accounting wise, if you increase these numbers, it is good for you. But reputation wise, it may affect you in the long run, right? So that means you need to go by the industry benchmark and then you have to take a decision about how much higher it can be. Okay, so what is the growth rate in AP? How can you find out that? Same thing, time T0 number minus T minus 1 number divided by T minus 1 number, accounts payable multiplied by 100. Okay, so if it is higher, it is good for you. Okay, whereas inventories and receivable, it should be lower, right? Yeah. So more or less we have come to the end. This is the last one wherein we are talking about capitalization, right? So that is nothing but proportion of total liabilities to total sources of funds for the firm. So what you do is you just look at the balance sheet of the firm, sum of the current liability and long term liability. Total liability is equal to current liability and non-current liability, sum of these two divided by total of the balance sheet multiply by 100 will give you capitalization ratio. For example, if the total of the right hand side is 1000 crores and your current liability and long term liability is 300 crores, that means your capitalization ratio is 30%. So what does it mean? Out of every 100 rupee in your balance sheet that has come to you in the right hand side, sources side, 30 rupees has come from borrowing, 70 rupees has come from owner's equity. This is the meaning of this, right? So higher the number, better is the performance of the firm, right? Positive effect of the borrowing at good times. When the time is good, borrowing helps you, right? But when the time is bad, okay, when the economy is not doing well, when the industry is not doing well, when you are finding it difficult, it is going to spell disaster to you, okay? So that is what you have to understand. For example, in this COVID-19 times, this is going to give you problem because on the one hand, you are not generating sales revenue. On the other hand, you have the commitment to pay your interest as well as principal repayment. So that means you may become bankrupt. You may find it harder to pay this, right? So that means you have to borrow, right, with the objective of improving your ROE. But when the time is not good, it is going to spell disaster to you. So you have to be careful in analyzing this number. Okay. The best thing is for all these numbers, you go by the industry average, compare your number with that of industry average. And then you conclude whether your firm is doing good or bad, right? So growth in capitalization formula is this: T0 capitalization minus T minus 1 capitalization divided by T minus 1 capitalization multiplied by 100. Okay, that's it, guys. So what we have discussed in this video are basically three questions. Question number one is, what does the balance sheet communicate? Question number two is, what does, right? How will you, right, make use of the analysis, right, of balance sheet items, and what are the items you need to consider for the same, right? So that's it. See you in the next video.